Welkom. Today we are in Grimbergen in Belgium. That's just above Brussels National Airport. And we fly today to Spa. It's a VFR flight that will take approximately 40 minutes in flight. And we will fly via two different VOR beacons. Because we are in Grimbergen, we are actually below the TMA of Brussels. So we will cross the Brussels TMA via different reporting points. Grimbergen has also procedure to leave the area, so we will take the runway 19er. If we open the IVAO window, we can see here in this line that Brussels METAR has a wind of 260 degrees 12 knots, which means that runway 19er is the logical choice in this case. The procedure to leave the area via the runway 19er is to take off, then turn 25 degrees left so that we can avoid the area with a lot of buildings, and then we will follow the crosswind leg at minimum 600 feet, but we also have to stay below 1000 feet, otherwise you are entering Brussels TMA. And once we see the train tracks, we will follow those train tracks to the first reporting point, Mechelen. Normally that's the point before we reach Mechelen, we will take contact with Brussels Tower. We will ask permission to enter the Brussels TMA, and then we will go via Mechelen, Peutie normally. We will get overhead the Brussels National Airport, and then we will continue to leave the area via Nossegem, Berchem and Haasrode. At Haasrode we will do a direct to Flo, of better known as Flora. Then we will go to the LNO without entering the TMA of Liège or the TMA of EBCI, so Charleroi. So there we will stay out of it. And then once we are at LNO, we will do a direct to Spa. So today we will only enter Brussels TMA. It's just easier, otherwise we have to fly around it. And we will have a really long flight. So there is no one online on IVAO. So there is no one to guide us to Brussels TMA. But we will do like it as a real situation. So we will fly from reporting points. And I am actually following a certain chart that you can find on the IEP of Brussels. So if you just take India, Alpha, Papa, and then Echo, Bravo, Bravo, Romeo, on Google you will find the IEP page of Brussels. When you go down, you can find a visual approach chart, and there you can see the different visual reporting points with arrows that show you how you have to move through the area of Brussels. So you can see if you want to enter from the north, we enter via the Mechelen and then we go to Peutie. And if you want to leave to the north, you will pass Abbeen Mechelen, but you will not use, for example, Mechelen. Alright, so the aircraft is parked for the moment, so let's start with that. We will take off the tow bars and the cords. We can see an aircraft leaving, the Oscar Tango November Tango, and apparently he is not using IVAO, so that's a pity. If you fly online, you should use Unicom to report your intentions. Alright, doesn't matter, we will do that. So first thing first, we will put some electricity on this aircraft. I won't do the checks today to spare some time. It's a simulation. I know that there won't be any problems with this aircraft as all failures are off. So transponder is off, radio is off, mixture is on rich, throttle is open. We select the left tank. I check both tanks are full for this flight. Fuel pump is on. We have fuel pressure. Fuel pump goes off. We prime four times. 1, 2, 3, 4. Actually, priming in this aircraft is not necessary, but in a real one, it's really important. Ignition. And engine is in the green. We have 1000 RPM. Check. Altimeter is on and we have battery charging. Transponder is on standby. Radio is on, we will squawk 7000, we have no contact with ATC, so 7000 is the correct squawk code. If we would have a tower here and we are in contact with Crim Baron Radio, I suppose, then we will have squawk normally 2000. 7000 means VFR and no contact with any ATC service. Alright, so the radio is on. We will just check the other thing, so we will align this with the compass. We will take off runway 19er. And I will actually directly... I will wait for that. We will then put the heading book at 25 degrees left, so that we know how we have to turn once we take off. Alright, we will just check the QNH. It should be 30.1013, and that's correct with the elevation of the field. Okay, and yeah, it's indeed Crim Baron Radio here on 119.505, but that doesn't exist on Unicom. Just checking, there is no one online for the moment, so we will announce our taxi. Oh, that's the wrong button. And then we will just check everything is ready for the taxi. So we have aligned our DI. We have the correct direction. The horizontal is normal. Speed indicates 0. Vertical indicates 0. We have the correct altitudes and QNH setting. The transponder is on standby and set. We won't need this for the moment. But what we will do is the first that we will need is flow. So flora is 112.05. We will put that in. Alright. And we will activate that. He doesn't recognize it for the moment. That's bad. Okay. And we will also put in nav 2. The 112.05. Alright. And what we will do is we will directly tune the correct heading for the for both VOR, so we will use Flora twice. First direct to, so that we will do en route, and then we will have for the second one we will use Flora to guide us towards a point where we will intercept the LNO, and that radial will keep us outside of Maastricht and Liège, and that at 107 degrees. So we will already put that in here. I think I'm too far. That's 110, that's 105, 6 and 7. Alright. So now we are ready to go. We will put our landing slide on. And the anti-collision light was already on. Should always be on when the engine is running. Alright, we will look around us. I can't see anything. So we can see here on the map where we are. We will take off in this direction, 19er. So, and as you can see when I'm zooming out, Brussels is here, and the TMA of Brussels is approximately this circle here, but with an exception of this triangle where we are there, it's actually some airspace G if you are below 1000 feet. Alright. Parking brake is off. Normally, we won't have any clouds below 2,300 feet, but I have no idea if this is will also be like that on the sim, because the clouds that we can see here are pretty dark and pretty low. But we will see. Normally, meta is in our favor, but sometimes the weather of the sim is not always correct. Why parking brake is off? Aha. That's a bit a problem with X-Plane, that you need a lot of power to start moving on grass, even if those grass panels here are actually made to park your aircraft on it. It's like they put a lot of friction on it that I almost need full power to move my airplane. Alright. Just checking, I don't have the charts for this, for the taxi here, so I'll just use the map. Alright, so we go here to the left and then we follow until we are on the runway. Alright. There's no traffic here. I suppose the aircraft that we saw earlier is already gone. Even if he doesn't communicate on Ivao, I don't want to bump into him. That he is not using runway 01, and that we are then lining up on the runway and that we are actually flying to each other, that would be bad, I think, in a real situation that will give a collision. Okay, I'm actually checking. Okay, I don't see him, just so I think he's already gone. That's good. Alright, then we will okay, so we will take off runway 19er. Climbing 800 feet. And then we will follow the procedure to reporting point Mechelen. Alright, so we will climb 800 feet. That's just to be sure that we stay outside the area of Brussels until we are at Mechelen. Once we are at Mechelen, we will continue to climb to 1000 feet. We have to stay there below 1500 feet to stay in the TMA of Brussels, of course, otherwise we are with Brussels approach. And once we are in Brussels, we will have to communicate our position, because we don't want to bring some problems with traffic, IAVR traffic that's landing in Brussels, as we will come overhead the field. Alright, we are now aligned with runway 19. We will then turn to the left. This is a bit weird because I need actually to go to the north, so is it? Just checking. Okay, I think once we are in 600 feet, we can go to. Alright. Power is set. We turn directly 25 degrees to avoid the buildings. We climb. There we go. We can see that the VORs get active, so we can already see flow. Six hundred feet, and we turn right. All right, there comes 800 feet. Reduce the speeds of, no, we actually reduce the power to become more correctly. We trim down the aircraft. There we go. We can already see the road here. That's the one going to Antwerp. And there we can see other road. I climbed a bit too early, so we will decrease for 100 feet to have some certain layer to stay away from Brussels. Alright. So now the aircraft is approximately trimmed. I don't have to correct the altitude anymore. Alright, here the road starts to turn, which means that we should be able now to turn. I don't see the train tracks, but it's possible that the sim didn't draw them. So, but I see when the road starts to turn, I think we can go a bit further. Yeah. And here we have the train tracks. Oh, I can even see a train. That's nice. Two trains. All right. So we will follow the train tracks, which will bring us to Mechelen. The reporting point, of course. Alright, Brussels is not online, so EBBR traffic. Inbound. Mechelen climbing 1000 feet. All right. We can already see Mechelen in front of us, that's the big road we are seeing. And then we will descend towards Brussels. Okay, we are here at Mechelen. Radio communication has been done. And we will turn towards the south. We will follow the road. And Putty will be a bit further. Normally Putty is a... You have a high object there to recognize Putty. Of course, in the sim it's a bit difficult to see. But in real life, you have always like something iconic that helps you to identify those reporting points. For example, it can be a bridge, it can be a tower, windmills, and so on. So now we have passed Pöti. In front of us, where we have the split of the two roads, of the merging of two roads, we have Brug Cargo. But actually, I will start to cross here over at the fields. That we cross actually the fields in the over the middle of the runway. That we are not any problem for traffic landing or taking off. At that stage, they will be on the ground. Normally, I don't see any aircrafts taking off. So I don't think in real life you can actually do this, flying over at the field of Brussels, because it's of course too dangerous. But as there is almost no aircrafts online, it spares a lot of time to do this. On all other small aerodromes, you can fly overhead, of course. Normally, it's the circuit height plus 500 feet that you will use. So, but maybe it's possible on, I don't know if they will allow it on IVAO, if tower is online, then it's the responsibility of the ATC controller if he wants to guide you overhead the field or not. So otherwise he will just ask you to go around the field, and he will just keep an eye out that you are not flying into IFR traffic by giving you some traffic information. For example, saying that at 11 o'clock you have that aircraft report in sight, and keep your own distance from that aircraft. We are in air class D here, so that means that as VFR we are responsible for our own separation with other traffic. ATC will only separate just watching that I have. ATC will only deliver the separation with IFR. So IFR between IFR will have some separation from ATC, but we are responsible for our own separation. We will get traffic information, of course. Right, this is the road. So we are here actually already at Nossenham. And we will go to Haasrode. So as you can see, the reporting points we are using now are always like on roads and so on, and that's easy to recognize on even on the sim. In real life it's always easier, I think, for the most part, because on the sim, the sim is not completely like in real life. Certain features are not there, like certain towers and so on. But of course, things like roads and bridges are normally simulated in X-Plane, making it easy to find them. But yeah, certain reporting points are really difficult to find. Certainly if you fly to Kortrijk, you have certain of them that's easy to see from the air if you are in real life, but difficult on the sim. For example, also Antwerp Sportpaleis is something you will recognize easily, but on the sim you cannot see the Sportpaleis, of course. So that makes it a bit more difficult. So we are now overhead. We just actually passed Nossenham, and then Haasrode will be in front of us, and it will be it will actually cross another road, making it easy to recognize. I will already type in the next. You are, and we will climb to one actually. So here we have actually already. Oh, it's not Nossenham. Damn, it's I typed the wrong in one. It's a Haasrode. All right, full power. And we will fly a heading of 90 approximately. And we can also see on our GPS that we have flow, meaning that we have the correct VOR tuned in. And we can see here that we are almost on track. We should fly actually a bit more to the left. And we can see the 2 flag on because we are flying to the VOR, which is also important. Otherwise we will be flying in the other direction. So normally now we are still in Brussels TMA. In this part it's until 2500 feet. It's not the same TMA here, we have the TMA-5 that we are in it. That's also covering the military domain that we have van Beauchamp. Of course above Beauchamp we are not allowed to fly as it is a military domain. But we can fly in the TMA, and once we are at flow, we will leave controlled airspace and we will remain in airspace G. Okay, 2000 feet, nose go down, power is reduced. We will also lean the engine, reduce our fuel consumption. That will give us a bit more power as the engine will turn better when we start to lean. Meaning that we can reduce a bit the power to maintain approximately 2200, a bit low. We should have 2400. Alright. So sometimes you see that my height is actually going 100 feet above the height I actually want to fly. That's just because I'm actually trying to check my map, I'm doing different things at the same time. And it's, I think, one of the most difficult parts of flying is that you have always a lot of work to do. You have to check your chart, you have to do your radio communication. But at the same time you have to keep an eye on your instruments or on your aircraft. And making sure that you are still on the correct heading, on the correct height, and so on. And that multitasking asks some training, and as you can see, I have still some work on that to keep actually the movement of my aircraft in height and in heading as small as possible. So I really want to keep that offset that I go through of my true heading and my true height to almost nothing. So actually only I should only be able to climb actually only a few feet before I should actually see and correct it. So that's actually just training. You'd need to fly and to start feeling comfortable in your aircraft, and then you will try to see those small things and correct them directly. You will develop a certain screening pattern, or you will go through your different dials, you will check them, and then you will react on what you see, and then you will check your charts, for example, then you will go back to your different dials, and you will do some radio, and so on. And it's just that pattern that you will use and maintain to keep control of your aircraft and to screen everything And don't forget, we are flying via VAR, so you don't only screen your instruments, but also, of course, outside for traffic. In the sim, it's not always that easy because turning a camera is a bit slower than you can turn your head, but it's always an important feature. Okay, we are back on track, but we are still 80 feet too low, so I will try to keep up the nose of the aircraft. We don't need to climb a lot, just a little bit. We can also use the DMA, and we can see that we are at 6.7 nautical miles of flow. And the aircraft is nose heavy, so we will trim it a little bit. That's already better, eh? So for the moment I'm not using anything of the automatic pilot. I just try to control the aircraft myself. We will have to go a bit more to the right. So the most difficult part also on a simulation compared with real life is that you don't have any feedback of your aircraft. Normally when you fly an aircraft you will feel some what we call pushback on your yoke. So if you push your aircraft down or up, you feel a certain pressure because of course you have the air around your aircraft, the aerodynamics that will work on that. You actually use your force to pull up or pull down an aircraft, and you don't have that with a yoke on your computer. So when you try to keep your airplane level, you will use a certain amount of force to keep the aircraft there, and then you will use your trim to reduce that amount of force until you feel that you don't have to use any force anymore. And that's something you don't have with an electronic yoke on a computer, and that makes it a bit more difficult to control your aircraft. That's why I also have those margins, because I really have to screen the instruments. I have no feeling with the aircraft. If the aircraft is going down or is going up, I'm still sitting in a chair just in my living room. So that's also something that makes it a bit more difficult, but like I said before, it's good training to learn to screen your instruments and to have an idea of what your aircraft is actually doing. And alright, I'm losing track of my viewer. I was actually flying in the same direction, but as we come really close to the viewer now, it starts to get more accurate. So it's like a cone. How closer you come to the point where the cone starts, you will have it will always come narrower, and so the needle will move faster. Alright, we can see that we are at 1 nautical mile of the station. So the station is actually almost in front of us. We can see the needle moving really fast now because we are really close to it. So we will just fly now 90 degrees until we are above, and then we will go to a heading of 107 degrees. So in the beginning we will not trust the needle as it is above the station. It's 107, eh? So yeah, it's here. And when you are above the station, the viewer is not accurate, so because the signal of the station is always the lowest just above the station. It's what we call a certain dead zone. So when you overfly a VOR station, at a certain point you will lose the signal, and then 1 nautical mile or 2 further you will pick up the signal again, and then you can twist your needle again. So now we are actually looking at this here. This is what will help us. We will follow this from flow for 24 nautical miles. Alright. We will now try to pick up the needle. So we will have to go a bit more to the right. We'll start turn back as the needle comes closer, keeping up our height. And we are as good as on track. Now we will give the LNO is 112.8 and the first one. 112.8. Activate that. Oh no. Alright, Alano. And we will ask the 180 radial. And once we have this, we will fly directly to Alano. And we will just actually just will put it direct to Alano. I don't think we will have any traffic here, but... And, alright. Apparently... also a thing I think it's really a bit difficult is if you have to type your messages that you lose really track of your aircraft, as you have sometimes to type a whole sentence to give your correct position. If you speak you can check it, but yeah, when I'm writing I'm actually looking at the box and I'm typing down, and then as we can see we lose track of our VOR. Oh no, oh what am I doing? I'm looking at the wrong instrument. That explains the great offset that I had that I couldn't explain. Now I make my own offset. Okay, no problem. We will fly 30 degrees back. Now that was a stupid mistake. Should have looked at my lower OBS and not the OBS above it, but okay, nothing. Luckily I saw it on time and the offset was small, and we didn't enter any of the TMAs around us. Okay, come on, come on. So I think we flew actually through this corridor when we were flying from Kieviet-Hasselt to Düsseldünge in Luxembourg. So at the left-hand side we have Maastricht. with his own TMA, and on the other direction we have the airport of Liège, which is known for cargo flights in Belgium. One of the airports I actually never went to until now. I already had one time. I went one time to Antwerp after the terroristic attacks in Belgium. I had to take a flight there, and of course Brussels I also did, and Charleroi, which are two major aerodromes we have in Belgium. If you want to fly, and myself with a small airport, a small aircraft, I only flew to Antwerp, Lescoin, Lille, and of course Kortrijk, but I still have to do some the other aerodromes as an exercise. On the sim, I already flew one time on to Spa. It's a really nice aerodrome. So that will be fun. We have some time now, so I will just take up the charts for Spa that I know which ones, which runways we have and so on, and the taxi routes. There we have the route we saw the last time. That we used. It's nice to see some features coming back that we used during previous flights. Alright, Echo Bravo Sierra Papa charts. So normally all charts you can find on Google, certainly for Belgium everything is available. And we have here the charts of Spa. Alright, there is an area approximately that we have to avoid, and we have to climb to 2600 feet if we want to take the circuit. We will also switch tanks. So normally the leg that we are flying now on the LNO is 24 nautical miles. We can see that we are now, of course, we are looking at LNO. Can I see my DMA from here? Five nauticals to go. The next flight we will do actually is also a nice one. It's then we will continue from Spa and we will go to EBCI, so to Charleroi, and that would actually be really nice if we would have some ATC there. It will make more realistic to ask to enter the TMA and so on, or if Brussels Control is online or Brussels Approach, we will also just contact them then instead. As on EVAU, they will also cover that area. So it would be really nice for a video to show you how phraseology goes in controlled airspace. As until now, I think we have never had ATC when I'm flying. So, but we will see. put a bit more power because our speed is not that high. We can see the needle coming closer here, so it will be time to turn. Just will my RPM was 2400, it's 2300 now, so I'm just wondering if I have start of icing. So what I will do is the engine is doing weird, everything is in the green. Okay, heater is on. Doesn't CB have icing? Heater is off. Alright, we have 9 nauticals to go, and then we will need to tune in again the second one, which will also be 112.8. And we will need to fly a track of 130. right. 5 nautical miles to go. Then it's 10 nautical miles to the field, and then we can land this aircraft and end our navigation for today. So what I have done now is I have tuned again the Arano and the NAV 2, so in the OBS below, and we will actually use that to fly a from VOR, from radial from the Arano VOR directly to the field. So I draw a radial to SPA, and then I checked the heading so that I know which one I had to use. Really difficult. The aircraft has constantly the tendency to change the pitch, so I'm supposing that means we have variable winds here. A variable wind will actually increase or decrease the wind that goes over the wing, and that's changing actually the aerodynamics of your aircraft, letting your aircraft constantly pitch up or down. I think we have this here because even if the aircraft is trimmed, I constantly have to trim it back to keep it on track. Yeah, okay. If we look at the meter from Liège, we can see that we have winds, the wind direction that is constantly changing from 230 degrees to 290 degrees. So we are actually flying in that change, and that can influence the aerodynamics of our aircraft. We are climbing again. Once we are actually at the VOR beacon, I will climb to 2600 feet to join the circuits for SPA. And we will take runway 23. Now we will turn to 130 degrees. You will overshoot that a little bit to correct and to get back on the correct radial. And you will start climbing. Mixture on rich also for climbing. A good cooldown of the engine. The aircraft has really difficulties to climb. Alright. Reduce power. Keep the nose up there. There you go. There we go. Six nauticals. So 4 nautical miles to go as we follow the DMA. And I think we can see the aerodrome at 11 o'clock. We can see between the trees kind of a runway and a grass field. So that will be it. Alright, we have, if I look at the chart, a right hand circuit or a left hand depending on the air thing we follow, we will like this. So it will be a left hand circuit for the 2-3. We will come over at the field there, I think. Ting fast. No, we will join. Oh, it's a right hand circuit. So left. Over at the field. We should have been a bit higher to join actually the circuit. Okay, now we can decrease and we can start to descend to the circuit height. Alright, so we will have runway 2-3. Oh, a bit too low. Alright, we are in downwind. We can see. Alright, ABSP traffic, final 2-3. Alright, mixture is on reach. Fuel pump is on, landing slide is on, reduce speed, flaps is 1. Boy, the aircraft is really not working with me today. Okay, descent. A bit more power, the speed is a bit too low for the stage of flight. Okay. I'm gonna turn into base. Okay, there we have 2600. We're gonna turn final, keep up the aircraft. We're a bit too low. We're not ready to descend now. That's better. Alright. QNH is correct. The engine is in the green. And we are ready for landing. Alright. Put the message, put that away. I think the Oscar Tango, November Tango, is doing the same as we are. One of the legs of the VFR Tour of Evao. But of course without using Evao in his case. Of I mean without using the Unicom, as you should have seen him at least post one message when he was landing here. So it's a bit of a pity that people don't do that always. Okay, we will decrease the speed. Flaps is 2, heater is on, and we will start the landing. We are not well aligned for the moment. There will be crosswinds, so we will use the rudders. Alright. Yeah, a bit decreasing more the speed. We can decrease to 75 knots, 70 to 75. And we reduce the speed. Yeah, there was a lot of crosswinds. They really had to crab towards the runway at the end. Alright. Fuel pump can go off, flaps up and heater is off. Important to put the heater off to avoid that dirt from the road is sucked into the engine. As it doesn't have any filters of course, it's using unfiltered air. When the heater is off you use cold and filtered air. Alright. Traffic. Runway vacated. Taxi to apron. We will put out the transponder. Landing lights can stay on. Fuel pump is off. Heater is off. Flaps are up. Alright. So we speak about runway vacated when we passed with the complete aircraft the double line. It's important that you pass the line because those lines have been calculated that once you pass the line, an aircraft can still... move there. I was actually looking for my parking and I'm saying some stupid things now. So once you pass the line, an aircraft has enough space to land. If you didn't pass the line and you are actually saying that you have the runway vacated and in case of a controlled airspace, ATC is actually actually clearing an aircraft to land, it's possible that his wings will struck your aircraft. That's why it's always important to report runway evacuated after you passed the lines. Alright, we are parked now, we have 1000. Alright, we will put the transponder off, radios off, idle, mixture to idle of cutoff. Engine has stopped. We will put already the altimeter off, ignition off. Landing light should be off before, but that doesn't matter. Anti-collision light off, instrument lighting is off, tank to cut off, parking brake is set, yoke is placed back, battery is off. And we can hear that the gyros are spinning off. And then the last thing we have to do is put the chokes on. And voila, we are parked and stowed in Spa. So welcome in Spa, this was the navigation flight for today. I hope you like this video. If you like it, you can always put a thumbs up on this video. And if you want more, please just subscribe to my channel and I will try to make more videos like this. I like to explain several parts of the flight, so if you have any questions, just put them in the comment box below and I will make a video about it, or in one of my videos I will talk about it. I also am planning to make a video about how you actually have to plan one of those flights where you are actually going from point A to B, how you start to prepare a flight like this, because of course now I do this always off screen, but I really like to do it on video so that you can see if you want to try it for yourself on the sim, how do you have to do it, using a chart or using the internet and so on. So the next flight will be to Charleroi, and I also hope that we then will have some ATC that I can show you how you have to use some phraseology to speak clearly, and of course with the shortest time to ATC. It's not the idea that you have to speak fast, but it's the idea that you have to be to the point. You want to say from high tower, I want to land to your field, and I am actually for the moment at 4000 feet, I somewhere there, and so on. That takes a lot of time in it, and certainly in aerodromes where there is a lot of traffic, you have to be short. It's like from an example then from, okay, I am a Piper 28, so actually in a correct phraseology you will say, for example, Charleroi Tower, Oscar Echo Lima Sierra Piper 28, overhead reporting point X, altitude 2000 feet, request entering your field for full stop landing. Your message has been passed with, I think, the least amount of possible words to make a correct and a complete message. They know your positions, they know your intentions, and they know who you are. In communication, we have always the to who I am speaking, to who am I. So, for example, Charleroi Tower is to who you are speaking. Oscar Echo Lima Sierra is who you are, and you will give a bit more information if you are flying via VAR. Via VAR flight from, for example, Kortrijk to your field in a Piper 28, and then where am I? Reporting point X, altitude X, and then what is the message that you want to pass? Request entering your area for full stop landing. Alright, so this, but I hope we will cover more phraseology the next time. I thank you for watching this video and hope to see you the next time. Bye bye!